Tabernacle Man.
Teaching biblical principles to a sight and sound generation.
Have you ever been blamed for something you were not responsible for doing? Do you have memories as a child where you're punished for something you know your brother and sister had done? Or maybe more recently, has your boss ever accused you of something at the office? You knew the guilty party was sitting right there next to you. You didn't want to point fingers, and no matter what you said in your defense, it always fell on deaf ears. All of us have felt like the scapegoat at least once in our life. In today's lesson, we're actually going to find out where the word scapegoat originated from. Our study comes from Leviticus chapter 16. We're going to be learning about the goat for Azazel.
Getting caught red-handed doing something wrong? Never a pleasant experience. Being blamed for something that we didn't even do? Well, that's even worse. Today, I want to talk to you about scapegoats and scapegoaters, those that are being blamed and those that are blaming us for things that we didn't do. There's a picture of this in Leviticus chapter 16. And Leviticus chapter 16 talks about the duties of the high priest on the Day of Atonement, Yom Kippur, the most holy day on the Jewish calendar. And so I want us to go to Leviticus chapter 16. We're going to look at the first 10 verses closely, and then we're going to go up to verses 15 through 28 and read through those. Trust me, I realize that most of us look at the book of Leviticus and say, oh, it's dry, too many details, it's an ancient practice, an ancient ritual, it doesn't apply to me today. Hang on, let's go through. So Leviticus chapter 16, verse 1. And the Lord spoke unto Moses after the death of the two sons of Aaron, when they drew near before the Lord and died. Whoa, what's happening here? We start off this chapter and we find out that two of the four sons that Aaron had were killed by God. What was it that they did? Well, to understand the context of the two-goat ritual, the scapegoat and the goat for the Lord, we have to go to Leviticus chapter 10. So we got to peel back about six chapters. Read with me, and we're going to look at just the first two verses. And Nadab and Abihu, the sons of Aaron, took each of them his censer and put fire therein and laid incense thereon and offered strange fire before the Lord, which he had not commanded them. And there came forth fire from before the Lord and devoured them, and they died before the Lord. This is pretty severe punishment for doing something wrong. In another lesson, we'll look at the strange fire and the different opinions as to what the strange fire was and why the penalty was so severe. But for our purpose today in learning about the goats that would be offered up that day, on the Day of Atonement, we need to look at this context. Before we move any further, we have to say some reason that the death of these two sons starts this chapter. Well, let's look at what happened. It took the children of Israel about 9 months to build the Mishkan, the tabernacle, the dwelling place for God. It was their attempt to have a tangible means of drawing close to God, to designating, sanctifying, setting apart, making holy a place where they could communicate, a place where they could look to and say, our God is with us. Now, the scriptures are plain that God cannot be contained in a house. But they built the tabernacle after the incident of the golden calf. The golden calf, unfortunately, grew out of their impatience, and they needed something to look at, something tangible that they could say represented a God, and they chose the golden calf. And from previous lessons, we realize that the golden calf, the calf was by no means an accident. Once again, they were set free from Egypt, They were no longer in Egypt, but they still had a whole lot of Egypt in them. And once again, they were looking to the zodiac, the stars, to direct their life, and they called it a god. So after 9 months of building the tabernacle, there was going to be a seven-day celebration or an inauguration, pretty much like we do with presidents. There's all types of parties and rituals and different things. But here, the celebration focused around worshiping God. During that seven-day celebration, after Aaron and his four sons have been anointed to be the priest, to start this lineage serving God, the priesthood, at some point, two of his sons kind of jumped the gun, did some things that they weren't even assigned to do, and they offered strange fire. Now, I don't want to go too deep into that right now, but there's a lot of strange fire being offered before the Lord today in many of our houses of worship. You can look at the footage that's right before you, and this is the model of the Mishkan, the model of the tabernacle. And you will see that outside of the tent itself, that square structure there, there's a bunch of pillars or poles that have a base of copper and a top of silver, and there's wood that is the pillar. That wood would have been acacia wood. And you'll see that that entire area, which is 75 foot wide and 150 foot long, is wrapped in white linen. That meant that anything inside that linen was considered sacred, set apart, made holy for special purposes for the worship of God. Anything outside of that was more in the common realm. And as you look inside, the first thing you see is the altar of burnt sacrifice. And next, that copper basin with the water in it is the copper laver for washing that the priests used every morning before they started their service. And directly behind that, you see the first five pillars of the Mishkan. So somewhere in here, they went inside that tent and went into the holy place where the menorah, as you can see in our footage, the menorah is on the left side, the table of showbread is on the right side, and the golden altar of incense there next to the veil. That veil that you see there, we have a larger picture of the life-size model of the tabernacle. And you can see that directly behind that golden altar of incense, you see the two cherubs and their wings spread there in the red portion of the veil. So no matter what it is that they did, they went into the holy place and offered something that was prohibited by God. So let's go back to Leviticus chapter 16 and look at verse 2. And the Lord said unto Moses, speak unto Aaron thy brother, that he come not at all times into the holy place within the veil, before the ark cover, which is upon the ark, that he die not. Now, this is setting the stage that the high priest only went into the Holy of Holies one time a year. And there were specific duties that he would do inside there before the Ark of the Covenant, before the mercy seat where the cherubims were on top, only one time a year. Now, I have to stop here for a moment, and this will be another lesson that we'll unpack later. Many people are mistaken and say that when Aaron or any of the high priests after that went into the holy place on the day of Yom Kippur, that they were dressed in all of the golden garments, and it had the breastplate and the red, the blue, and the purple, and the white ephod and the mitre with the gold plate that said holiness unto the Lord on it. Folks, that's just not true. The only place that he would have wore that is in the outer court or in the holy place, not in the Holy of Holies. As we will see in this portion of Scripture, Leviticus chapter 16, on that one day a year, he exchange the golden garments and don the four white linen garments to go into the Holy of Holies. So the Lord told him, you're not going to go in here just any time, any day, only one day a year. Verse 3, herein shall Aaron come into the holy place, this Holy of Holies, with a bullock for a sin offering and a ram for the burnt offering. He shall put on the holy linen tunic, and he shall have the linen breeches upon his flesh, and shall be girded with the linen girdle, and with the linen mitre he shall be attired. These are the holy garments, and he shall bathe his flesh in water and put them on. Verse 5, and he shall take of the congregation of the children of Israel 2 he-goats for a sin offering and 1 ram for a burnt offering. This sin offering that they're talking about here was one of the 2 mandatory offerings. The other 3 were voluntary acts of worship. And the sin offering is one that is provided for atonement of unintentional sins against the Lord. And the type of animal that was offered depended on your status. But on this day, on Yom Kippur, the 2 goats that are offered are for the entire nation of Israel. And it talks about 1 ram for a burnt offering, and this was the one of the voluntary offerings. And it basically meant all I am belongs to God. The nation of Israel, we belong to you. So who are these offerings for? Well, let's go on over and look at these 2 goats. We have Skippy, and then we have Billy. That's the name some children in a Sunday school class gave them. And what would happen is on the Day of Atonement, 2 goats that were about the same size, the same weight, worth about the same value, pretty much the same color, the same age, were brought to the front of the tabernacle, the gate of the tabernacle, to be inspected. First to make sure that they were holy. First to make sure that they were kosher. First to make sure there were no blemishes, no blind eyes, no lame leg, no mange on the belly, but to make sure that these were ready to be presented to the Lord. And what would happen is the high priest would be presented these goats before him, and they would stand before him, and he'd have a box in his left hand, a little small wooden box, and a little small wooden box in his right hand. And inside each one of these boxes was a phrase that was written down. We're not sure what it was written down on, but one of them said, the goat for the Lord, and the other said, the goat for Azazel. Now, we'll look at what the word Azazel means in a little bit, but it's been translated in many English versions as the scapegoat, the goat for Azazel. And what would happen is he would open the first box and the one in his left hand, and whatever it said in there, that's where that goat would go. So for sake of teaching purposes, let's say that the goat on the high priest's left hand was the goat for the Lord, the goat that would be offered up completely on our brazen altar to the Lord. And for teaching purposes, let's say the one in his right hand, when he opened it up, it said the goat for Azazel. So here is what would take place. First, he would take the goat that was selected for the Lord, and he would lay his hands upon it and press in, the Hebrew says, press in and confess the sins of the nation. Now remember, this is not a personal offering. This is an offering, a goat offering, that represents the nation of Israel and the sins that they may have committed as a nation before the Lord. And he would confess them on them. And to make sure that this goat did not get mixed up with the other goat, they would take red wool, a ribbon, and on the goat for the Lord, they would tie this around his neck. So that distinguished him. This goat would then be taken and prepared as an offering, prepared to be burned up on the altar of burnt sacrifice. And as I said before, this goat, when it was placed on the altar, no one ate of this goat. It was completely burned up because it was a whole or burnt offering that was the people's attempt at drawing close to God and saying, God, our nation belongs to you. We represent you. We are your light to the world. And forgive us for that which we've done wrong. Cancel the penalty of our sin. Well, once that was taken place, then the high priest and his assistants would come, and now we have this other goat. This is Skippy, the scapegoat, I call him. And Skippy, the scapegoat, is not going to die this day. This goat died almost immediately. Skippy, he was also selected by the lottery. By the way, this is a lottery where everyone lost. Both goats end up losing. And the high priest would press in again on his head and confess the sins of the nation. But this goat, as I said, wasn't killed, but we wanted to make sure it did not get mixed up with the other goat ever. And the red ribbon on him was tied around his horns, distinguishing him as the goat for Azazel, or what is commonly known as the scapegoat. So now this goat was taken, and there would be a succession of different men that would take, have a rope around this goat's neck, and lead him outside the camp. Now in tabernacle days, out in the middle of the desert, they would take this goat outside that white linen fence that you're looking at, okay, through the tabernacle gate or the entrance, past all of the tents, all of the tribes, and way beyond, and each succession of person would lead it further and further away from the camp. And it would be banished in the wilderness, banished where God's presence, so to speak, did not exist, banished to the darkness, banished to never come back inside the camp. And the reason why the red wool was put around its horns is, if this goat, like many animals, tries to find its way home, tries to find its way back inside the camp, people would throw rocks at it, shoo it away, make loud noises, and keep it out in the wilderness. Eventually, with no water and no food, this goat would die. This goat was for the guilt that was associated with sin. The goat for the Lord was associated with the penalty for the sin of the nation. So this goat eventually died also. Now, why red wool? Well, at least in the tabernacle time, the thought was, is if you happened to stumble upon where this goat had finally died, you would know that the sins of the nation had been forgiven because the sun would bleach this red wool white. Hence the verse in Isaiah, though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be white as snow. By the time of the first and second temple, in the common era, this ritual changed. People got impatient. Rituals change, rituals are modified. And what they would do with Skippy here is they would still have that succession of people leading the goat out of to the wilderness, so to speak. But now that the temple was in Jerusalem, they just didn't take him as far. And they would take him to an area where there would be a cliff, a rocky area. And some people believe the word Azazel means rocky or a place with cliffs. And they would take Skippy here, and after they would lead him there, they would back him up to the edge of that cliff and then push him over to fall down and die and broke up on the crags in the rocks. So he would die pretty much the same day as the Day of Atonement. Some say that it became kind of a community celebration, and as the goat was being led through the streets of Jerusalem and moving outside the city proper, that kids would run and throw things and call the scapegoat names. So the practice was hastened. So that is Skippy the scapegoat, the goat for Azazel, and we'll just call him Billy, the goat for the Lord. Let's go back and look at the word Azazel for a moment. Now, I don't want you to read too much into this, but the word Azazel later became associated with HaSatan, Satan, the accuser, the enemy of our soul. And so you see that there's horns on these goats. And if you look in some of our ancient art, the Middle Ages, the Dark Ages, the art that was coming out, Satan was pictured as having horns. I'm not sure when he donned the red suit and the pitchfork and the long tail, but at one period in art, he was always represented as having horns. You can see on the screen there a picture of Satan and Skippy the scapegoat that was made in Paris in 1825. And people started representing Satan, as I said, the devil, in some people's traditions, as having horns. There are some scholars that believe that the goat for Azazel was some type of offering to, once again, the nation of Israel slipping off into Egyptian ways and practicing some type of rituals with foreign gods. I'm not sure about that. I don't want to read too much into that. But just remember, there was the guilt of sin and the penalty of sin that needed to be taken care of for the nation that day. Let's return to verse 6 now of Leviticus chapter 16. And Aaron shall present the bullock of the sin offering, which is for himself, and make atonement for himself and for his house. Now, why a bull as a sin offering for Aaron, the high priest, and his family? As a constant reminder once a year of the golden calf incident, and that the priesthood needed to serve the Lord, not the Egyptian gods or gods of any other nation. In verse 7, and he shall take the two goats and set before them the Lord at the door of the tent of meeting. And Aaron shall cast lots upon the two goats, one for the Lord and the other for Azazel. 9, and Aaron shall present the goat upon which the lot fell for the Lord and offer him as a sin offering. But the goat on which the lot fell for Azazel shall be set alive, not killed, but set alive before the Lord to make atonement over him, to send him away for Azazel into the wilderness. Now, the rest of this, these next verses have to do with Aaron and preparing the bullock for their offering. So let's jump to verse 15. Then he shall kill the goat of the sin offering that is for the people, and bring its blood within the veil, talking about within the veil that separates the holy place from the Holy of Holies, within the veil, and do with his blood as he did with the blood of the bullock, and sprinkle it upon the ark cover, before the ark cover, or the mercy seat that sat upon the box of the ark where the covenant between God and his people rested. And there shall be no man in the tent of meeting when he goeth in to make atonement in the holy place until he come out and have made atonement for himself and for his household and for all the assembly of Israel. And he shall go out unto the altar that is before the Lord, or our altar of burnt sacrifice, and make atonement for it. And he shall take the blood of the bullock and the blood of the goat and put it on the horns of the altar round about, and he shall sprinkle the blood upon with his finger 7 times and cleanse it and hallow it from the uncleanliness of the children of Israel. So what's going on here? He's taking blood from the goat that was offered up to the Lord, and he's cleansing or sanctifying, making holy, setting apart the altar of burnt sacrifice so it would be presentable before the Lord for another year. Now, why the horns? Well, the horns represent power, the power of the altar, the power of forgiveness, the power of restitution, the power of reconciliation, the power of repentance, the power of making things right with God, the power of approaching God and giving these offerings in an attempt to draw close. So the sins of the nation didn't accumulate. Once a year on the Day of Atonement, this ritual would take place. Verse 20, and when he hath made an end of atoning for the holy place, so that means that the tent itself had to be atoned for just in case things have been happening that shouldn't have been happened to, in the people's mind, set it apart again at least once a year, reconsecrate it, take care of it, make sure everything was appropriate for the Lord. At the end, and when he hath made an end of the atoning for the holy place and the tent of meeting and the altar, he shall present the live goat. So after he had taken the goat that was given up to God and offered it to God and used the blood to cleanse the altar, to cleanse the holy place, to cleanse the Mishkan, the tabernacle, then is when the goat for Azazel was led out alive by the hand of appointed men into the wilderness. As I said in the beginning, it's never easy when we get caught red-handed for something we've done wrong. But it's worse when we get blamed for things that we didn't do. And sometimes we scapegoat people too easy. Some people, they feel like they've been blamed all their life. They may have grown up in an alcoholic or drug-addicted home or a compulsive gambler or other types of confusion going on. And there seems to be one of the kids that just seems to get blamed for everything. When people look at this kid in the family, they say, well, that's why this family has problems. But many times, they're being blamed for things that they're really not responsible for. Yes, they're acting out, but it's because of the stress and the craziness that's going on in the home. These things happen in our house of worship too. We blame people for some of the silliest things. And what we really need to do is look at that on the Day of Atonement, there was an acknowledgement that the penalty of sin had to be dealt with, that the nation had done wrong. But so we didn't have the opportunity or take our right to blame somebody for the things that had went wrong in the nation, the Lord provided a way for the guilt of sin to be banished outside the camp. That's right, banished outside the camp to never come back in the camp again. And we need to realize when the Lord forgives, the Lord forgives. When people confess their sin, whether it's individually or as a nation, we have to let it go. We have to quit blaming people and heaping guilt on them. We're not perfect, folks. None of us are. And sometimes in our attempts to draw close to God, we goof up. Sometimes we don't even want to draw close to God. And we get lackadaisical. And we kind of err. We get weak in our spiritual walk. We need God's people to be there to help us to get back on the right track. Because guess what? Except for the grace of God, there go you and I. Let's not scapegoat people anymore.
Thank you so much for sharing this time with us. Truth of the matter is you could have been somewhere else watching something else, but instead you chose to be with us, and for that we are so grateful. Our goal here at Kohanim Ministry is to present biblical principles to a sight and sound generation.